Thank you very much, Christopher. And we're going to turn our attention to Larry Holmes against Muhammad Ali in just a moment. Right now, these words.
The WBC World Heavyweight Championship, Larry Holmes versus Muhammad Ali, is brought to you by Pontiac.
Quickly as possible, we're going to turn our attention to the fight held October 2nd past between Larry Holmes and Muhammad Ali. Both fighters are here, will be talking with me after you view the contest, as I called that contest that night. But to give you some of the pre-fight flavor, I spoke before the fight with both fighters. Larry alleged that Muhammad was using a hypnotist. Muhammad denied it. And thus, we pick up at that point in the conversation with me talking first to Larry Holmes.
And you're convinced that despite his denials, he is seeing a hypnotist.
I think so, Howard. I think so. He lost a great deal of weight. I don't feel that he lost this amount of weight because he's been training so hard. I think it's because he's haven't been eating. I think I got him so that he can't eat. He will be weak on the night of the fight. I will go to him. I will make this man fight every second, every round, and I don't think he can go 8 rounds. That's why I'm predicting that I will knock Ali out. I will stop him somewhere from 1 to 8 rounds.
Few quick questions that we have to consider before this fight. How is it possible you haven't fought for more than 2 years to have your reflexes and your skills the way once they were?
Charles Carter, my sparring partner, 22 years old, 160 pounds, same height as Holmes, I'm faster. Jeff Stoudemire, top-notch fighter, 22 years old, 6'2", I'm faster. Marty Monroe, world 8th ranked heavyweight, 24 years old, I'm faster. You watch, that's why I say you see a miracle. I've had 2 year rest, 2 years off, you're right. 2 years off, take what you said, and I'm going to whoop home.
But I can understand your resolve, but what about your resiliency? Your muscle tone, losing all that weight.
Muscle tone, perfect.
Look. Haven't you lost some strength?
No, I'm not. If I did in 2 months, I've been working 6 months. I did this gradually. I've done today 15,640 calisthenics. Oh, man, I'm ready. I wouldn't come back and go out a loser.
Isn't this difficult for you? Many times you've expressed your respect for the man, even admiration. Once he was your idol. How can you hate him now?
No, Howard, I don't hate him. I feel that I cannot hate anyone, but I feel that I have to get my just due. I have to get the monkey off my back. This shadow has been following me around for many years. I haven't really got my just dues. Everywhere I go, people say, Ali, what about Ali? What about Ali? What about Ali? I have to knock this man out for the people who say, well, he knocked the man out. But they're going to say he was old, so what? I'd rather them say he was old than say I was nothing.
Isn't that saying to me, in a diffused kind of way, that you can't get the recognition you think you deserve, even if you win?
Right, Howard. I don't feel that I'll ever get the recognition I deserve. Even if I win, if I break all kinds of records or whatever, I feel that the monkey is always going to be on my back. But we don't care about that. As long as we're happy and we be able to live with ourselves, I think we'll be happy with that, and I'm happy with myself now. I'm married, I got my kids, and that's all that matters to me.
His behind shall be mine by round 9. Did you hear me? By round 9, it'll be all over. Play this, just in case you think I can't do it, use this tape. I will destroy Holmes, and I want you to play this thing over to the public and make me like a fool. His behind shall be mine and 9. I cannot lose the Holmes. I cannot lose the Holmes. Now play it the next day.
There he is, the returning hero. Maybe not this time the conquering hero, Muhammad Ali. The man who hasn't had a good fight for the last 5 years, not since Manila. The man who hasn't even fought since September 15, 1978. He is 38 years of age now, and he must undertake the task of reproving himself all over again. The man who has held the title an unprecedented 3 times and seeks to make it a 4th. Incredible. He has taken off more than 50 pounds in the last 6 months. How much strength can he have left? What will his tactics be? What will his weapon be? Nobody really knows. He has been obsessed with the desire to establish that Larry Holmes is afraid of him, as Holmes has been obsessed with the desire to establish that Ali is afraid of him. He is only 217 and a half. The lowest weight he's been since Kinshasa Zaire, when he weighed 216 and a half and rope-a-doped Foreman into extinction. Muhammad Ali, now in the ring, awaiting the arrival of Larry Holmes. Larry Holmes, the man who thirsts for recognition, who has pointedly said, even if I win, even if I knock him out, they'll say I knocked out an old man. Larry Holmes, who's used an old tactic, a one-time Ali tactic, at one point in Muhammad's career, he kept Muhammad waiting in the ring. Let him sweat some more. Let him think some more. Maybe worry some more. But here comes Larry Holmes, the WBC heavyweight champion, a man who deserves recognition as a solid fighter, the possessor of a fine left jab and a good enough right, unbeaten in 35 bouts, 26 KOs, 211 and a half his weight, his height 6'4", his reach 79 inches, 3 inches less than Ali's, who is 6 feet, 3 inches tall. So Larry Holmes, on this day, can spring from anonymity. And yet, oddly, the whole atmosphere in Las Vegas has been one of people coming from all over the country, hoping that somehow Muhammad Ali, as you look at Larry Holmes, can draw upon some inexhaustible resource. There he is. He is scaled down so he looks positively thin, at least in the face. There is the championship belt, which Holmes now owns. There's been a lot of talk about Ali using a hypnotist named Jimmy Gripa. Ali poo-poos it. There is Ali, much the way he looked in Kinshasa Zaire as they screamed, Ali, Boumaye, Ali, Boumaye. He is back in the ring. Whether he comes back as Muhammad Ali or merely a vague shell, a replica of what once he was, remains to be seen. That's the uncertainty in this bout. Talking to Larry Holmes now, as they are putting on Larry's gloves, the familiar figure of yesteryear, Drew Brown Bundini, will be back with the start of the WBC. Ali still trying to psych Larry Holmes, posturing, making faces at him, holding up four fingers and five fingers. He has said Holmes will be his within nine. Holmes being taunted by the familiar figure of the past, Drew Brown Bundini. Holmes has said he will go right at Ali. Ali has said, I only hope so. I only hope so. Fight will be scored on the 10-point must system. Three knockdown rule waived. Mandatory eight count. No standing eight counts. Once they had that in Nevada, no saving by the bell except in the final round. The referee does not score. The referee is a man named Richard Green. He is a veteran referee. I last worked a fight of his here in Las Vegas when Wilfredo Gomez had to go 10 rounds against the veteran Carlos Mendoza. Look at Ali and Larry Holmes. I respect Larry Holmes. I respect him as a fighter. I respect him as a man. As for Ali, his lifetime speaks for itself. During the turbulence of the 60s, the young people adopted him as an anti-hero. In the 70s, he actually became an establishment hero. And he has proved himself transcendental to the sport of which he has been a part, a figure in constitutional law history. We are about ready to go.
This is the main event of the evening. 15 rounds of boxing for the WBC Heavyweight Championship of the World. Introducing, in the blue corner, the challenger, the three-time heavyweight champion of the world, fighting out of Louisville, Kentucky, weighing 217 and one half pounds, introducing Muhammad Ali.
crowd stands as one for Muhammad Ali, Angelo Dundee, another familiar figure in Ali's corner.
In the red corner.
Here's Holmes.
Fighting out of Eastern Pennsylvania. He is going for a record, 8 straight KO in the heavyweight title defense. He weighs 211 and one half pounds. He is the WBC heavyweight champion of the world, Larry, the Eastern Assassin, Holmes. 15 rounds of boxing.
That scene spoke for itself. Ali trying to psych Holmes to the very advent of the bout itself. How much he succeeded, how much it will be forgotten once the action starts, remains to be seen. Rich Giacchetti, the manager of Holmes, in the corner. It's a 20-foot ring, big ring, favors a boxer who can move. Once Ali was unsurpassed in that regard. Ali carrying on with the referee, Richard Green. Green having trouble getting the fight started. The bell for round one. Wide-eyed, posturing Ali. Holmes, purposeful. Holmes really would like to make mincemeat of him early, if he can. 25 seconds into round one. Ali retains one splendid weapon, always his best weapon, the straight right. You see him covering there, peekaboo fashion. If Larry gets lazy with his left jab, which he's been known to do, he can become Ali's accomplice. Larry is not the wise ringmaster that Ali used to be. And a straight right could jar Holmes. That's what Ali has to hope for. Holmes does not intend to let the left jab get lazy tonight. First round action, a minute 20 seconds. Remember this about Ali, there has never, not ever been a man who can take a punch better than Ali. Holmes will work down to that midriff, trusting that the loss of flesh has left flab in there. Now remember, we are fighting in what has been an oppressive heat. That may be a major factor. It was 100 degrees today. It may be close to that under these lights tonight. We are into the final minute of round one. Ali, 56 victories, 3 defeats, 37 KOs. Round one. Ali. You saw him motion Holmes to come on. Ali will seek to use his upper body to maul and brawl Holmes the way he did Leon Spinks. But Holmes is a far better fighter than Leon Spinks. Holmes's task is not to lose his head, not to be outsmarted. We're approaching the end of round one. The bell for round two. Ali to the left, Holmes to the right. Holmes quickly using that swift left jab. It is not a weak jab. It is a jarring jab, stinging. And notice how frequently he will seek to go to the midsection, testing what he feels must be flab left by the tremendous weight loss. Third man in the ring is Richard Green. Ali has said he doesn't want to go out the way Joe Louis did and others have. Jim Jeffries tried to come back after being away for years against Jack Johnson. He was demolished. Good right to the belly by Holmes. A minute into the round. The left jab sticking by Holmes. Ali posturing and talking, but not punching, not at the moment. The crowd chants, you hear them, Ali. Minute and a half into the round. Ali looking, waiting to get the right in. Larry's hand, left hand down, perhaps a touch too far. Watch that Larry Holmes left hand. Now he got it back up to throw it. Doubled and tripled on it, scored only twice. Into the final minute of round two. So far, Ali doing little, if any. Round 2. Holmes being careful. An occasional flurry like that. Test out Ali. Final seconds of round two. Holmes's round. We're about ready for round three. There's the bell. At ringside, it is 86 degrees in the ring under the lights, a lot more than that. With Ali, you must constantly look for strategy, trying to outsmart the opponent, beat him with the mind, and then ultimately with the fists. So, you wonder, is he figuring that the heat, together with Holmes' frequency of jabs, will wear down Larry and then give him, Ali, the opportunity to use the right? Or is Ali just fighting physiological laws that can't be overcome? A good quick right by Holmes. 50 seconds into round three. Holmes continuing to use that jab. Ali kept at bay. A good combination by Holmes. He is younger by 7 years. He is now much faster than the fastest heavyweight who has yet lived. Holmes, as you can readily see, doing all the scoring. Quick left to the face, then down to the midriff. A minute 35 into round three. Again, a good combination. And a little bit of hurt appeared in Ali's eyes, but Ali continues to talk to Holmes. Into the final minute of round three. Holmes is aware of Ali's right, knows that what is left is in that hand. Thirty seconds left. Ali continues to talk, muttering to Holmes, challenging him verbally. The verbal truculence does not equal the fistic truculence. We're almost ready for round four. Larry Holmes has won the first three rounds quite clearly, quite cleanly. Ali has thrown one right in the first round that did score. That's been about the size of it. The rest has been talking to Holmes. Holmes has been fighting behind his left jab. Occasionally, he's thrown rights in combination. Particularly good combination by Holmes in the second round. Into round four. And Holmes continues to use the jab. Got a good one in to the belly. The belly and up to the head and the double to the head and back to the belly. He's diversifying his jab very effectively. In the meantime, Ali having trouble even getting to Holmes, because Holmes's left is so keeping him at bay right there. And again, but Holmes will be wary. No matter what he wants in the way of recognition, he doesn't want to make a mistake. Too much latent respect for the ability that used to be there to risk finding out what, if anything, is left. Crowd roared as Ali suddenly sought to move in with a right. Seems to me there is a swelling to Ali's face, and most particularly under the left eye. There is no sign of blood. Round 4. So far, Holmes having a cautious cakewalk. Again, to the belly, after to the head. And again, there's the occasional right, then the left. Ali in the corner. Crowd roars every time Ali flicks.
You can hear referee Green in the background cautioning Ali about holding on to the rope with one hand flicking with the other.
Bell for round five. Let's see if Ali can begin to put some punches together. Now you see him moving, using the ring. First time he's done that. Thank you. Now let's see how Holmes handles this. Fifth round action. The right lead by Holmes. Notice how Holmes is varying location on his jabs. In that pattern of to the face, to the belly, back up, back down. Minute 10 seconds gone in round five. How much of this can Ali do in this heat after all these years? And he is not scoring points while he does it. That was a good flicking left jab. Two quick lefts to the belly by Holmes, then up to the face. Not scoring well with the one to the face, but the again, belly and head. Again the face. Holmes posturing for Ali now. Ali talking back. But they fight with blows, not with chatter. Constant rain of talk from Ali, but the lefts keep coming into his face. Well, you saw Ali shimmy like his sister Kate. Holmes had done it earlier. 25 seconds left in round five. Oh, a good, sharp left jab by Holmes. You see him doubling and tripling. So far, it is utterly no contest. We're back in Las Vegas, Nevada. Angie Dundee working over the damaged eye of Ali. Heard Dundee say you've got to start firing to Ali. Dundee just asked Ali if he was all right. Ali said yes. This fight for the WBC World Heavyweight Championship, that was the bell for round six. There is a little red welt under Ali's left eye. It has been, up to this point, no contest. And you see more of those lefts going in. Scoring steadily against Muhammad Ali. And I repeat, Holmes has had excellent location with his jab. This is sixth round action. And in the last 30 seconds, Ali is doing better with his jab, getting to Holmes's belly than he has done in the prior five rounds. But Holmes now comes back. Ali against the ropes. He was warned, you'll remember, in round four about holding on to the ropes and hitting at the same time by referee Richard Green. There was the right of Holmes, and it jarred Ali. Rich Giacchetti in the corner yelling, dig into him. That's it, Giacchetti said. We're almost 2 minutes into round six. Ali, not winning this round, in my opinion, but making better use of his left jab than he has in the fight until now. Cicchetti yelling, that's it, up and down, with the jab, he means. And Ali, too, saying the same thing. I don't know how that serves Muhammad, but it's all right with him, it's all right with me.
Set him up now, that's it. Hit it again. Set him up with the jab again.
Get it up there, Ali is done. Get it up there. Hit me harder, Ali said, and so Holmes did. From the roof of Caesar's Palace, the ring behind it, where Holmes is defending his WBC heavyweight crown against Ali. All right, round seven. And no question, Ali's left eye has tightened. It is smaller and it is swollen. The Holmes jabs have taken their toll, and Holmes may be ready to seek to unload a little more loosely than he has been. He has been, as I said, enjoying a cautious cakewalk. Now Ali, or rather Holmes, answering Ali in a way sneeringly with his shimmy. Last time Holmes did that shimmy, he purposefully walked Ali to the center of the ring, where Ali said he wanted to meet him. Ali dancing on his toes now. Seventh round. Ali got in a couple of good jabs. I mentioned that in the sixth round, he began to get his jab working to some degree. And he's working it better now. And the crowd is responding. A minute and a half into round seven. Ali getting in and out in a hurry with the jab. Now, against the ropes, covering up as Holmes tries to get at him. Apart from the one caution about holding the rope, referee Green has had an easy time of it. ...45 seconds left in round seven and counting down. Not a great round, but Ali's best round up till now. See that? Ali doubled on the left successfully, and Holmes was angered. Ali covering, and yet two of the lefts got in, and Holmes, getting angry, went at the belly with the right. Oh, a good left and a right that sent Ali back against the ropes. Ali quickly covering, and even trying. Well, there he is. Angie Dundee talking to him. Ali's best round was that round, the seventh round, and yet it's hard to score it for him. The way Holmes ended the round. Previous six rounds, Holmes was doing what he wanted. Ali's left eye grows smaller. I don't know what words of counsel he could get from Drew Brown Bundini. Now you can see the discoloration under Ali's left eye.
Stretch out on him, and I bet you he's done. Stretch out.
Bundini talking to Ali. Bundini may be more famous for some of the limericks he's contributed to Ali. Bet on Sonny and lose your money. But that was 1964. This is the eighth round, and quickly Holmes scored with a left to Ali's chin, and then another. What was it Ali said? Holmes will be mine in nine. Well, we're getting close. Again the left, and again. Veronica, Ali's wife, watching. She didn't want him to fight. He paid no heed. This is the eighth round, scheduled 15 rounds. Holmes has been systematic from the very first bell. This round, Ali, as Holmes tries to get through that peekaboo guard of Ali's, this round Ali has not been flicking the left the way he did in round seven. He has virtually not thrown a successful punch. Ali, the look of a terribly fatigued old fighter. The right eye now getting discolored, as well as the left. Ali may be hurt. He may be pretending, but he may be hurt. Twenty-five seconds left in round eight. And Holmes continues, systematic, methodical, purpose. Larry Holmes having a field day. Ali gets wearily to his feet as we prepare for round nine. There is a flow of blood under the left eye. It is sad to see this, as the left working away of Larry Holmes. Calling the splendor of the man, speed of hands and feet, the way it was in 66. Oh, that right hurt Ali when he demolished Cleveland Williams at his positive peak. And at 67, when he gave it, oh, he's ready to go. This must be stopped. It is a sad way to end. Well, they will not stop it. What's my name, he said to Ernie Terrell as he clobbered him. Terrell, a tough fighter to beat. He was kind to Zora Foley, all those fights. And now this. This is the ninth round, the very round that Ali had said would certainly be the end. He'll be mine in nine.
crowd screaming, chanting, Ali, Ali. Legends die hard. And Ali is learning that even he cannot be forever young. His hands are no longer busy. His feet no longer swift. ...35 seconds left in round nine. It appeared it might be stopped within the first minute. But referee Green elected not to. Oh, he is taking a pounding. As Holmes, now realizing that Ali can no longer hurt him, is letting go. So we have been through nine rounds, and Ali sits in his corner. And one thinks about the man's pride and his self-respect.
Are you all right?
Are you all right? Dundee asking Ali. Dundee, who cares about the man, together so long, who cares about Ali's pride and self-respect. It must be killing him to see this happen to Ali. Here was the corner action.
Seconds out! Seconds out!
Ali gets to his feet ever so slowly for the 10th round. His left eye is all but closed. His right eye has narrowed. He was flawed once by a fighter named Banks. He was flawed once by Henry Cooper, the test tube leader in Wembley in London. And he was, of course, flawed on March 8, 1971 by Joe Frazier. Ali Frazier fight one in Madison Square Garden in New York. This is the 10th round.
Come on, that's it. Dig in, dig in. Bring it up, Big Jack. That's it. Go in. Stay on. Stay on.
A minute gone.
Right back. That's it. Right in. Right in. Right in. Right in.
Holmes' corner keeps telling him to use the right hand to punish Ali. There was the right into the midsection. Holmes scoring at virtual will. Sad to witness this, isn't it? A minute. Counting down. Round 10. I realize the legend that this man has been. I would hope they would stop this fight. 30 seconds left. Savage.
Come on.
This fight should be stopped. Angelo is telling the referee to stop it. Bundini is arguing with him.
Check him out.
What you want to do?
The game's over. I'm the chief second.
All right.
I stopped the fight.
All right.
He would not give in, Angelo Dundee. He cared about his fighter too much, the way Eddie Futch cared about Joe Frazier too much in 1975 in Manila to let him come out. It is a sad way to see this great man's career end, but it seemed inevitable. I talked about the laws of physiology. So now the scene in ring center, and Larry Holmes is the heavyweight champion of the world. He didn't fight spectacularly. He didn't know what Ali had left, if anything. He fought carefully, and he fought wisely, and he fought well. For Muhammad, he must face the final curtain.
That's the way it was, ladies and gentlemen. October 2nd past 1980. We are live in the studio now with Larry Holmes to my right, the WBC heavyweight champion, Muhammad Ali to my left. First question, Larry, do you feel you've gotten the monkey off your back? Do you still feel cheated?
No, I don't feel cheated, Howard, but I still feel that the monkey be on my back because that's the way it is in this game. You cannot satisfy everybody, so who cares? I just want to be able to satisfy me and my family.
Controversy surrounded the fight in view of the aftermath of the events. Do you feel that the victory was tarnished by A, the drug controversy, B, the urinalysis controversy?
No, I don't think the winning the fight was tarnished because I fought a great man that night. I felt that the pills didn't have anything to do with the way this man was fighting. It was all Larry Holmes. Larry Holmes had something to do the way he was fighting. Every time he wanted to get off, I was there first. But not taking anything from Muhammad, I think he's a great athlete, he's a great human being. And I always think he would be a great fighter, a great person. But I don't see that this man is capable of fighting me anymore.
All right. Now, you folks know that after the fight, Muhammad Ali went to the UCLA Medical Center. And it was there disclosed that he had been taking a drug known as Thyrolar. And that was for the treatment, presumably, of a hypothyroid condition. Do you feel that the taking of those drugs nullified you that night?
Well, Howard, first of all, I want to say, Larry Holmes is great. He's much better than I ever thought. When he was my sparring partner, he wasn't near that good. I have that image in my mind. He was a great fighter, but I knew I could have done better. He's the true champion. I advise all my followers until I get him back. He is the man. And I want people to say, all my followers, he's the man. But I know it wasn't right. If you saw the thing close, I didn't perspire. I was a little too weak. I took punches. And they stopped it because I was too tired, really too tired to continue. I'm not making excuses. I never do. But that night, I wasn't right. And I think that is a great man because he says I can get another shot if I prove myself by taking on top contender. And I think I look so bad that night, I don't deserve a shot at riding him. I'm no champion. I think I should come back and knock out somebody and show that I'm still who I am, the greatest of all times, and prove it.
All right. You remain determined to fight again. What I'd like to get to now is that drug controversy. A few weeks back, your personal physician, Dr. Williams, was on our late-night news show, Nightline. Ted Koppel asked him why he prescribed Thyrolar for you to take before the fight. Here's Dr. Williams.
About 2 years ago, while in New Orleans before the Sphinx fight, I discovered that Dr. Ali was suffering from hypothyroidism, and this was confirmed by laboratory examinations, and his appearance in the following months confirmed my impression that he was suffering from myxedema.
What is that in layman's terms?
Well, hypothyroidism to an extent where there is the swollen appearance of the face which simulated that caused by kidney trouble and a swollen appearance of the arms and legs and the abdomen. Therefore, I treated the condition in order to bring him to a normal state of metabolism.
Now, Dr. Williams, forgive me, I'm a layman both in terms of medicine and in terms of sports, but it seems to me that if Muhammad Ali was suffering from that kind of a condition, he shouldn't be in the ring at all.
Well, I went to Las Vegas during the third week, prior to the bout. And prior to that time, he had been approved by the Mayo Clinic and also approved by the boxing commissioner's doctor, Dr. Romano, in Las Vegas. And therefore, it was my duty, I felt, to see that his water balance, his salt balance, and his general condition were such as to provide him with maximum endurance and performance for the fight.
Well, as to water balance, which Dr. Williams just mentioned, Muhammad has said, "I didn't sweat." And he has said he was dehydrated. Now, you watched the fight. Did you see Muhammad sweat?
I did more than watch the fight, Howard. I was in the fight. And when I hit him with a punch, I could see water jumping off of him. And watching the fight now, you cannot see him really perspire that much. But by me knowing Muhammad and knowing myself, I perspire a great deal when I'm fighting. He didn't perspire as much, but he was perspiring.
Okay. Now there was another controversy, ladies and gentlemen. It involved the urinalysis that habitually takes place after a fight. In Muhammad's case, there was the discovery of drugs. In point of fact, the urinalysis didn't occur till some 3 hours, or the specimen wasn't taken, after the fight had ended. In this regard, earlier today, I talked with the chairman of the Nevada State Athletic Commission, Mr. Sid Rogish, a gentleman of some considerable experience in boxing. Here was my conversation with him. Well, we'll have that conversation in a second. I want to explain further that what was found in the urinalysis was essentially an antidepressant drug and what in effect was a tranquilizer or painkiller. And the commission had intended involuntarily to render Ali retired. They did not do so. Instead, they received legal advice from the state attorney general. The conversation explains. Sig, since it's the avowed intent of your commission to place Ali into involuntary retirement, why the forthcoming hearing where you've given him 30 days notice to respond?
Howard, he's entitled to his day in court, as anyone would be in a situation like this. And we should hear the facts and then make our final determination.
In other words, due process of law.
Yes, sir.
You don't want a repeat of what was done in 1967.
I just want Muhammad Ali to know, and his people to know, that we're going to give them every opportunity to present their case.
Do you think a question of drugs is involved here?
No, I don't believe so. I think it's more a question of what's best for his health and his safety and the integrity of the sport of boxing.
All right, if you don't think drugs are involved, and we'll deal separately in this show with the question of the thyroid treatments, let's deal now with what you have jurisdiction over, the urinalysis after the fight. Dr. Wurgis took the specimen. That was several hours after the fight. In the interim, according to Dr. Williams, Ali's physician, he had given Ali an antidepressant and B, in effect, a tranquilizer to settle a fighter down. He said he thought Dr. Wurgis had already taken the specimen of urine. Do you take Dr. Williams' word for
it? I do. I think that he had nothing to gain by telling us otherwise. He's a professional doctor, and I just don't believe he would jeopardize himself in light of the Nevada State Athletic Commission or anyone else in a manner like that.
Sig, if in the course of your hearing you determine that Ali, in your opinion, based upon all the facts and evidence, should be involuntarily retired in your state, Is it your hope that the commissions of other states will follow suit?
I would hope so. I don't think there's any difference in a man's safety in one state as opposed to another, and I would hope that for the integrity of boxing that others would follow suit and give us the support that we need.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
So that was the chairman, Muhammad, of the Nevada State Athletic Commission. The intent, clearly, if the evidence adduced points to it, to involuntarily retire you, at least in the state of Nevada. But this time, you'll get a hearing.
It speaks like a just man. I don't like to say this, because even he or anybody come to work one day and they have laryngitis or they're not right, I don't think it's right to take his livelihood because he had a bad day. They were supposed to check my urine after the fight. They waited for me to go back to the hotel. 3 or 4 hours went by. Doctor gave me some type of anesthetic for my pain. Then they let me urinate into a cup. After I'd taken the anesthetic, then they found it. They should have been checking me out immediately after the fight. I went with me. Why come 4 hours later? So naturally something was in my system.
Well, they're not going to use that against you, as you just heard. Then they just feel that your boxing days have passed.
Well, I didn't get knocked down. I didn't really get hurt. I can name fighters, I don't embarrass them, who've been knocked out lately, laying out like that, fighting for every fight like that. They keep fighting. I wasn't hurt or knocked out, even in that bad condition. I wasn't really beat up bad. They stopped because I was too tired and wasn't right. So why deny me a livelihood because I had a bad night?
Why are you so determined to continue fighting?
Because
you've been a hero to many people
in
this country.
I don't want to be no fool and go out on my stool.
You said Holmes will be mine in 9.
I lied.
You're also crazy. You realize that, don't you?
It takes one to know one. But as MacArthur says, I shall return. Holmes is a just man. He says, let Ali prove he's qualified.
Well, is there another fight in the mill?
We're
now
working on a couple of top contenders. I want to come back. I did 4 rounds with Mike Reeves' sparring partner the other day in Kentucky. Danced and moving was beautiful. You heard about it. Anyway, I'm going to take on, tell all of you now, I'm going to take on a top contender and knock him out. Show you I'm supreme. And then I shall come back. And let me shake your hand, Larry. Thank you very much.
Who's next for you, Larry?
You are the great
champ. If Ali hurry up and knock somebody out, he'll be next.
Oh, man.
We're not going to worry about that.
Good luck to you both.
We're going to continue to go on.
Thank you both for coming by. You're two fine gentlemen. Really are. And good friends,
too. He's bad.
All right. Call you both champions.
He's the champ of the world.
That's it, ladies and gentlemen. Holmes against Ali, you saw it. And we end on a usually familiar note as Ali seeks to reprove himself all over again. Under any circumstances, a reminder, Jim Watt won on a technical knockout in the 12th round over challenger Sean O'Grady over in Glasgow, Scotland. All the judges' cards at the time the fight was terminated favored Jim Watt. In the meantime, too, remember, tomorrow, 12 o'clock, New York time, beginning first game of a doubleheader over most of these ABC stations, NCAA college football. It'll be 4th-ranked Georgia. Thank you, Larry, very much. And you'll see 2 of the great running backs of the country, Herschel Walker of Georgia against George Rogers of South Carolina. Then regional games
of Muhammad Ali.
Think in terms of bridges burned. Think of seasons that must end. See the rivers rise and fall. They will rise and fall again. Everything must die again, like an ocean to a shore, like a river to a stream, like a river to a stream. It's the famous final scene. How you tried to make it work, Did you really think it could? How you tried to make it last? Did you really think it would? Like a guest who stayed too long, now it's finally time to leave. Yes, it's finally time to leave. As the light fades from the screen, from the famous final scene.
I'm young, I'm handsome, I'm fast, I'm pretty, and can't possibly be beat.